One day in spring, Nokomis came to Nana Bojo and said, "For a long time, I have been without oil to put on my head, and now my hair is fast falling out for the want of it." Nana Bojo remembered that in a lake nearby dwelt a spine-backed sturgeon. A fine source of oil, who preyed upon swimming animals and fishermen and was so huge that he could swallow even a full-grown moose, antlers and all, without difficulty. He only appeared above the surface at the moment of attack. The rest of the time, he skulked about in the depths of the lake. Nana Bojo decided that the only way to destroy the great fish was from within. In some way, he must contrive to have the sturgeon swallow him whole. Then he could carry out his attack. His grandmother was greatly concerned when she heard what he'd planned to do. But he said to her, "Do not fear, Nokomis. Go, make me a fishing line of cedar bark." Then he started to construct a birch bark canoe. He built the framework from the boughs of cedar trees, bending them into the shape that he wanted. Then he cut a great sheet of birch bark and spread it on the ground. Laying the skeleton of the boat upon it, he drew the birch bark tightly over the frame and with a bone needle and some wattrap, laced the edges. Then he sealed the joint and lacing holes with hot pine gum. When his canoe was completed, the big man stepped into it and set out on his perilous adventure. He paddled to the center of the lake, let down a line, and began to chant a loud, defiant war song to the great sturgeon. He called him many unpleasant names and dared him to come up from the depths and do battle with him. Nana Bojo's raucous voice echoed in the deep waters and caused all the fish to dart about and gave the great sturgeon a headache. "Silence that noisemaker," he shouted to the trout. "Go, take hold of his fish line and satisfy him." When the trout came to the surface, holding on to the line, Nana Bojo was furious. "Go back to the cowardly sturgeon and tell him to come up and fight me himself, if he is not too frightened," he said to the fish as he freed it from the hook. "Go, for I shall sing my war chant until he does." And he returned the fish to the lake. Nana Bojo then increased the noise he had been making, and in desperation, the great sturgeon rose to the surface himself. Opening his huge mouth, he swallowed the big man, canoe and all. Nana Bojo bumped his head against a great row of teeth and became unconscious. When he came to, he found himself inside the stomach of the fish. Though it was pitch dark, he could see, for he had eyes like a cat. Soon he realized that he was not alone. The monster had swallowed other creatures that day. There were bears, deer, beavers, foxes, and even a red squirrel. Only the squirrel seemed to have any courage left. The others were quite without hope and expected to die at any minute. The big man called them together. "Listen, my brothers," he said to the trembling animals. "If we all work together, we may still escape."
Yes, yes,
chattered the squirrel.
"That is just what I've been trying to tell them, but no one can think of a plan."
The squirrel was bouncing up and down as she spoke, and the sight gave Nana Bojo an idea. "We can make it very uncomfortable for the fish if we just jump about inside his stomach. I will sing my war chant again for you to dance to." Filled with new hope, the animals began a frenzied war dance, leaping and shouting and banging on the walls of their prison. The squirrel leaped as energetically as the others, but she was so small that she was in danger of being trampled. Nana Bojo placed her on his shoulder, where the valiant little animal shouted encouragement. The great sturgeon became nauseous with the noise and the turmoil in his stomach. He turned over several times in the water, trying to quiet the creatures who were troubling him. This sent them all rolling topsy-turvy and made them breathless. But as soon as they had recovered, they started up again. And Nana Bojo pounded on the fish's great heart with his war club, causing the fish to feel very ill. "I must get rid of them," the sturgeon rumbled. "I will throw them out into the center of the lake where they will all be drowned." From her place on Nana Bojo's shoulder, the squirrel could hear the sturgeon's voice even above the din. She leaned over and called into Nana Bojo's ear.
"Pull your canoe across his throat. Hurry, hurry."
Just as Nana Bojo did this, a great convulsion tumbled everyone towards the fish's throat, but they did not fall out. Instead, they clung to the canoe, which lodged in the passageway. Nana Bojo laughed as he saw the squirrel perched on the canoe, chattering busily and flicking her tail in the excitement. "From this day forward," the big man said, "you shall be called Ajudamo, which means tail in the air." Nana Bojo next attacked the sturgeon's heart in earnest, and soon the fish was dead. Its body rose to the surface of the water and floated towards the shore. Then it scraped against the sand. While the animals were arguing about how to make their escape, Nana Bojo could hear a scratching sound. Soon a hole appeared in the fish's belly and light shone through. He peered out and found himself looking at some seagulls. "Make the hole larger," he called.
"It is our brother, Nana Bojo,"
the seagulls cried to one another.
"Let us help them escape."
They all began to peck and scratch and make the hole larger. And by, Nana Bojo and the animals were able to step out on land once more. Nana Bojo thanked the gulls. "From this time forward, you shall be called Kayoshk, which means noble scratchers," he said, "in token of your kindness to me." When Nana Bojo returned to Nokomis, he found her waiting anxiously. He told her to prepare oil from the fish and to take what she needed for herself. Then he sat down to make up a song to tell of his exploit. Oh, and as for the squirrel, who scampered off into the woods, she's chattering about her adventure to this very day.